This might be the most in-depth tutorial and review of the East West Hollywood Orchestra Opus Edition. Hi there, this is Sam with Second Tier Sound. Really nice to see you here. So, finally, the Opus review. And I'm sorry I kept you waiting. It was partially because I had to wait for an okay from East West, who were kind enough to give me a review copy. And I want to give a shout out to Blake and Michael, who were really kind to me and helped me out quite a bit. So this is going to be a biggie, so I'm going to divide this into three parts. And this first video, the one you're watching right now, will be about the Opus engine. And it will be more of a technical video. You know, you won't hear much how it sounds, unfortunately. But I think you will appreciate this because you will really learn how to master this engine and get the maximum out of it. And then the second video will be about the orchestra. We'll compare a little bit to the play engine and see what new additions are happening. And then the third video will be the orchestrator. And then I will also give my sort of final review score. I mean, I won't give you a score, but my thoughts on it. So then you can see if this is something for you or not after you've seen all these three videos. Obviously, if you have the subscription, there's nothing to think about. Anyway, let's get going with this tutorial slash review, the Opus engine. Let's open up the Opus engine, and I'm going to open up the play engine as well so we can compare a little bit, because maybe you're still thinking, should I upgrade if you still have the play version? So let's look at just how the window is handled. And as you can see here in the beginning, there are quite a lot of tabs and buttons and all kinds of stuff going on. Otherwise, it seems like it's kind of similar in the way the browser is working. Let's start with the menus. I know this could be a little bit boring, but I think you would find this really useful, actually. So the Opus is just what version, so not so interested. But these three bars are handled a little bit differently than how it's handled in the play. Here in general, this is about instrument handling. And I want to say first that I don't know if Play was thinking of this the same way, but these are not patches. They are instruments. And I've always called them patches, so maybe I'm completely wrong about that. But Opus calls these things instruments. So if you want to open an instrument, you want to save an instrument, that's what you should look at. Okay? Not the patch. If I understand correctly, I haven't found it anywhere in the manual, but I think patches is basically if you want to create several instruments loaded up in one patch. I think that's the way it's used. I've done that myself in the past. For example, here, I created my own patch of several instruments. Could be wrong, but I think that's what it is. But anyway, it's true that these are instruments, so you got to know it that way. All right. So you probably want to use this menu a lot, but I think you might use the save instrument, which I will talk about a little bit later. Then we have the cogwheel, and this is really good. Here is where the Opus engine starts to shine. I have a lot of really important options that all sample players should have. Let's look at preferences first, and this might be a little bit misleading. When you look at the names, you think, oh, this has to do with my controller or my ASIO driver or something like that. No, not at all. This is only referring to the Opus engine. So the audio engine uses your hard drives. And here you can set what hard drive you have. So if you have an old mechanical hard drive, you set that. And that means that the Opus engine will use way more RAM. So it will tax the hard drive less. And it's also slower. So that's the why. If you have an SSD SATA that I have right now, then it will work more with the hard drive and use less RAM. And if you happen to have a PCIe, then I think it uses hardly any or maybe no RAM if you have a very fast PCIe. So in this case, I have it set to this one. Never preload can be interesting if you want to save some resources. I haven't played with that myself. Then multi-threading, and I think most people have multi-threading CPUs nowadays, but you can set that on or off in terms of how you handle the reverbs and the voices. It could maybe help you with your performance a bit. And you can even set what kind of performance you want to have, minimum, medium, and maximum. So this is good if you have a slower laptop or if you have a power computer, you can really set that up there. Then this is really great. You can now set how many stereo buses you want to have. So in this plugin, the one you use in your DAW, usually you have more. So maybe you have several instruments loaded in one Opus set, and then you can have them routed to all kinds of different channels if you really want that. Also, in the standalone version, the one you use outside of your DAW, you can even set several channels there. Very nice. Audio drives. So it's not, you know, as a lot of people, or as I thought, I would say, that this is about what kind of audio driver I'm using. No, it's really how you use your hard drives. So I have three here. And as you can see, my C drive is actually a PCIe. So I've set it to that. Now, I don't have any samples here, but if I would to have any samples on my C drive, then the Opus Engine would handle those differently because that is a faster drive. Very good, this. MIDI refers to how is Opus going to handle MIDI. So auto increment means that every instrument that you load to an Opus Engine, it will add a MIDI channel. So if I have five instruments on one Opus Engine, it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 MIDI channels. If I do Omni, then all the different instruments will be controlled by any controller. If you don't have a lot of different instruments in your Opus Engine, then maybe Omni is better for you. And if you want all the patches you have loaded to sound at the same time, you also want Omni. But I prefer auto increment. Round robin is a technique that almost all sample libraries use. It's a sort of repetition tool, so it doesn't sound like the exact same thing. And this is a reset that you can control with the CC. This is CC16. You can change this if you want to. So when you reset the round robin, it will start over. You can also do that by adding a key switch if you put a note on your keyboard, for example. Then articulations. If you have key switches and if you don't want them to show up in your score, there are other ways to do so. But you can do the old school version of click on this, and then you can change those with your program change instead. Locations is basically when you download new libraries, where will it go? And in what region will the server be in so you get faster service? Why is this important? Well, because now you can actually download directly from the Opus Engine. Very nice. And then you can choose if you want to download without asking. Other, very nice. Well, the meter decay, how long you want the meters to stay on, is maybe not the most important thing, but it's nice that it's there if you want it to stay on forever. Zoom, Player, UI, and Performance UI. We're going to talk about these tabs later, but you can basically change the size of these tabs and then the UI will actually adjust itself, so it will be bigger and smaller. You might want to turn it off if you find it annoying or it taxes too much on your graphical card. Show alert pop-up and toolbar. This means that if there are any errors or anything that you need to be paying attention to, it will come up a triangle on your Opus Engine. I don't have it on because Opus is, when I do this review tutorial, in its early stage. It still works really well right now, but are small issues that happens now and then that I wouldn't worry about because they are working on it and it's not breaking anyway. But then it will come up and tell you that. So I turn it off so it doesn't bother me. Load with effects off, fantastic option, because now what I've done by default, that each instrument is loading with a reverb on, which is very nice. It sounds good immediately, sort of the perfect reverb matching that. And I like that. But you have to remember that if you load a bunch of instruments, to have an individual reverb on each instrument will be very taxing for your system. And maybe it's not the sound you want. So I actually have this switched on so that I won't have a reverb loaded with my sound. If you want that, just make sure it's off and then the reverb will load with your sound. Okay, I'll have my own reverb set for all instruments. So what else do we have in this menu? Well, we have a toggle instrument, inspector, and keyboard. And you can do that here or you can just use the buttons that are up here. For some reason, the player is moving when you add the left one, which I think is a little bit odd. It should just add it, but there it is. So you can add the keyboard here, and you also have some new nice controls here. I will talk more about these two in a bit. So what else do we have? Well, we have detached player, which is very nice because now you can have both windows open at the same time. And if you have, for example, two or three monitors, you can have just this one on one monitor, and you can just look here without having to close the play all the time. Before, in the Play engine, you have to go back and forth between the different tabs. Okay. So, what else? Well, we have Zoom. And this is interesting because there are actually two ways of zooming, but they do it differently. This refers to text only. So I will actually change the text size. And I like this, but for me, this is too small, first of all, depending on your resolution, obviously. But what's interesting here is that maybe I want the text to be bigger. Fine, I can do that. Oh, it didn't go bigger here. There we go. That's great. I actually prefer this size. I'm getting old here, but I just want, it's easier on my eyes to have a bigger text. But then the whole player gets bigger as well. And the funny thing about that is that I can't really make it smaller. So it's a lot of real estate here, I find. I mean, this all depends on how many instruments I have, but I wish I could make this smaller so it doesn't take up so much of my screen. Because now I prefer not to have the zoom. Because you have to remember, I didn't add all these panels. If I do that and zoom 125, it's just going to take up too much space. I'm not going to be able to see it all. So that wouldn't help with a bigger screen, because if you have higher resolution, you still want to add the zoom. See what I'm saying? It's weird, this thing. Good that it's there, not functioning so well. The other way of zooming, I'm going to talk more about these tabs later, but it's basically you can drag. The play and the perform can be dragged, and this is really nice. Well, let's not get ahead of ourselves here. So we have a few more tabs here. We have Browse, which is the same as Browser in Play. We have Play, which is the same as Player in the Play engine. We have Perform, which is completely new. And we have Mix, which is pretty much the same as Mixer. I'm going to talk more about all these different tabs in detail, and obviously they all have new functions, so they're not exactly the same, but they're similar. So let's look at the browser in detail, and they have really upped the game here quite a bit. And I want to say other sample manufacturers or players, pay attention to what's being done here because it's really, really good. The first obvious thing that a lot of people already know is that now when you click on the instruments, you will hear what they sound like. Now, this is fantastic if you got an enormous library. Maybe you have the Composer Cloud, you have thousands of sounds, and you don't want to load everything to hear what it sounds like. So this is really, really key. In terms of just having the orchestra, it might not be the most useful thing because you know what the instrument sounds like. And all these legatos, they sound the same on the surface. It's just how they're handled. So it doesn't really make much sense there. So you can turn it off if you find it annoying, and you can even change the volume here if you want it louder or softer. Okay? And then we have Add, Replace, and Replace All, which is pretty much the same as before, but the Replace All is added. It's just quicker that way. It did sort of exist in Play as well as a pop-up question, but now it's just there from the start. But what's really good here is that each instrument you click on, you will get a description, and not just, oh, it was recorded there and it sounds great. No, it's really telling you how the CCs are used and which ones are used and what the dynamic layers are. So you know how to control it. So now you don't need to watch my videos anymore. It's helping you a lot. So if you forget something, it says right here. You can just read about it and understand more how that particular instrument is being used. So that is really, really good. And then you have Database, which is also fantastic, especially if you have the Composer Cloud of tons of instruments, because now you can search for specific things. You can put in different parameters here, articulation, size, style, timbre, or whatever, and you can find more what you're after. Just like Complete Control or Omnisphere is doing. So that is just really, really, really good. And now you can add other libraries, but the Composer Cloud is massive, so they don't need to. But it would be nice if you could add other libraries eventually. We'll see. Okay, but one thing I really love here is the Quick Load. This is so, so, so good. Let's see if I can explain this the best way. Let's just open up this tab here so we can see a little bit more. And I'm going to open a pretty big, let's take this one and let's not use Quick Load. How quickly this loads up. So you will see that this is 880 megabytes, more or less, in RAM. And again, you know, it's faster than the Play. I do want to say that if you're still using the Play, if you have excluded from your antivirus, it's not that slow anymore. And I think that's what a lot of people compare to. They say, Play is so slow. Yeah, it's because they haven't used that trick. But now, when you've done so, the difference is not that big. But Opus is still faster. Oh, yes, it is. Okay, so Now you see it's 880 megabyte. Let's close this one and let's click on quick load and click again. First of all, it loaded way faster, but it says 0 bytes. 0 bytes. What does that mean? I can't play it? Yeah, I can play it. No problem. So what's happening here? Well, as you can see, now it turned yellow. And suddenly we have also more megabytes here, but it's not 880. So what's happening here is that each key I hit is loaded from my hard drive into memory. Why is this so good? Well, because I can now load a whole template of 50 or 100 instruments where everything is zero from the start. Imagine what that does to my RAM. And I love this because now I have these enormous templates which are loaded with zero RAM. And it's not just that. When I play, maybe I don't use all my instruments in that template that day. Maybe I use only 5 instruments. I still don't have to sit there and destroy my RAM, make my computer tired by using all that RAM that is not used. I will only use what is necessary. And even better, only the notes that are being played are necessary, not all notes that exist within the range. This is so crucial. This is so good. I'm so happy about this. So let me show you how it controls. You don't have to use quick load. You can load the sample fully if you want, but then you can click on the green, load it into memory. You can click red, it's all gone. Yellow you can't click on because basically when you play, it loads in, right? So there it is. And I would just basically always use purge. And then when you've finished the whole song, you can just play the song once and the Opus will load only the sample that it needs to use into memory, which is fantastic. Fantastic. Imagine what it will save on your resources. Your computer will run way better that way, especially when you're going to mix and if you don't want to freeze the tracks or bounce them, for example. Okay, let's talk about this panel a little bit. So here you can load several instruments. Let's load just another one. We can add a quick load so it goes faster. And it kind of looks almost like Logic in a way or a simple sequencer. You can turn the instrument off entirely, which is not really the purge, but you just turn it off. You can change the name now, which is fun, if you want to name it something that makes sense to you. You can change the volume, panning, you can mute it, solo, and all the purge function here. You can also change the outputs and the MIDI channel. Now, this function sort of exists already in Play. I want to show you, here it is right there. But you don't have the purge function, and you don't have all that panning control and stuff like that. So you have a little bit more control in your player, which is nice. One more thing that you can try out is also the right panel. It's not the most useful. It's a little bit the same as in the Play Engine. You can see a bunch of information about the sample. But these panels are a little bit more useful in, for example, Play, Perform, and Mix. We're going to look at that more later. Okay, so let's take a look at the Play tab. And they have added quite a bit, but there also is a lot of similarities as before. So let's just look at how similar this actually is. You have the microphones, you have the HDSR right here, you can change that. You have the stereo doubling up here, you have the reverb there, the tune and master and all that. You have some similar buttons, portamento, legato, repetition. These are different scripts, the concertino and all that. So what is different? Well, quite a bit, it turns out, if you look more closely. But the main one that has been sold is these mood presets. And they are great. I really like this. First, I want to say this only works if you have the Diamond Library or you have the Composer Cloud Plus. Because otherwise, you don't have access to these mic positions and you can't use these moods. I also want to say that you can use these moods in your play. Well, not really. You don't have a nice button that changes everything. But you have access to all the controls in Play. I will show you what I mean. If you do Classic here, it's the normal one that loads up. It's the main mic that is loaded up and the reverb if you have it on or off. All right? But if you click on, for example, Soft, it will turn blue. But what it does is that it adds the Sordino effect, which you can add yourself by clicking here. It adds a different reverb, which you don't know which one it is, but you have the option to change that, right? And it changed to mid-mic and it lowers the volume a bit. You could also do that here. You can change the mid-mic. So this is a preset that is added very nicely here. And it's great because it loads quickly and you don't have to mess about. It takes quite a while to do this in a play. But I just wanted to say that you can do modes in play too. You just don't have a fancy button for it. Well, let's look at epic. And instantly changes to close and main mics, changes the reverbs, and has no sordino. So it adds a different sound. I do want to say, though, there's no massive change in the way the instrument behaves. It's still going to have the same articulation and sound. It is changing more in sort of subtle energy, I would say. So don't think that you put on red and now it's going to roar and sound like there's a massive distortion on it. You can still do that if you want it yourself, but it's not a massive difference that really is going to change how you sound like. And now it's going to sound like this epic orchestra. No. It is a great preset you can have in order to change the sound a bit. Okay, well, let's look at what else they have done here. Well, one thing I really like is that they have added this MIDI control here. This is new, and I really like it because a lot of people don't like the way East West have handled their dynamic control. Because most libraries out there, I'm talking mostly Kontakt libraries, are using the CC1 mod wheel for dynamic change. You know, when you turn the mod wheel, the sound will sound louder and softer. In most cases, East West has not done it this way. And I think it is because they wanted to have vibrato control there. And then they used the expression to change the dynamic layer. It does make sense because if you only, well, it doesn't make sense if you only have mod wheel, then it feels like a pain in the ass to control. But if you have several faders, which you need to really do if you're going to be serious about this, then you just use the expression layer instead. And expression kind of logically makes more sense to use as a volume control, actually. In any case, if you don't like that, you can change it easily. And you just click here, and let's say if you want mod wheel, boom, there it is. Now expression is controlled with a mod wheel as well. And you can then just go and click Save Instrument, click, and now next time you load it up, it will still be that way. And somebody say, oh, I have to change all of them. Well, I don't know. Every time you load up a sample, you just change it right then and there. Then you never have to do it again. So that's an easy fix if you hate it that way. What else have they done? Well, they've added a few buttons here. And actually, I'm going to change the instrument so you can see even more what they've done. So I'm going to go into the browser and I'm going to add a key switch patch instead. All right, there it is. So let's go back to play. And as you can see, they now added the articulation button down here. So this is kind of similar to before. You can load and unload like this. But what's really great is that there are all kinds of articulations here that are not loaded into memory. So you can add them and remove the other ones if you don't want them. So maybe you find that this key switch patch doesn't really have what I need. It misses a lot of articulations. Well, then you can just change them right here. This is a great addition. You cannot change, not yet at least, the note here, but you can change it somewhere else. We'll come to that later, but you can change it here. Here you can only change what sound is loaded and how loud they're going to be with this button. So great. Then you have mic positions down here. And this is just an image, but it's not bad. It's really good. If you use the mic positions, you will love this because you will get a more visual image of what's going on. First of all, you see the whole orchestra, how it's planted. So you know, oh, the double basses are on the right and the first violin is on the left. Kind of nice to get a picture of what's going on. We will also see how they're mic'd. So if you use the closed mic, click here. You see, boom, there you go. It's only these two because I only have the violins loaded right now. You will see here now the C is on and they are very close. So you will understand what the mic positions are. If I then click on the mid, now they turn on right here, right? Then the deca tree is already loaded. So that's why they're loaded here. And then we have stage, which you don't see because it's part of the deca tree. That's why. And then you have surround, which is out here. Yeah. We can actually, if we turn off this, there you go. Stage mics are here. Because they're part of the deca tree. So that's a really nice image. It really helps you visualize how you want this. And it might be easier for you when you want to dial in your mics yourself. But that's not all. There's even more to this page. We have MIDI tools, automation, and articulation. So there's a lot of stuff going on here. So let's look at those. Let's look at MIDI tools. And we go in and it's blank. It's like nothing. Not really. You have to add things. And these are a bunch of MIDI tools that most DAWs already have. but it might be nice to be able to do it in your player, especially if you use standalone. So we add a MIDI tool and hear all kinds of stuff. And I'm going to talk briefly what they are. You probably know already, but arpeggiator is just an arpeggiator, which can be nice maybe if you do ostinatos, for example. Then the next one we have is chord scales, which basically set what kind of mode you're in. Very nice. What the root note is and how the chords are voiced. Very good. If you don't know much about that, it can help you a lot. Chorder is basically different chords. Same again, just chords then. Then we have Glide, which is sort of a kind of portamento tool. Probably works better with synthesizers, but you can try. You can maybe get some interesting effects with the violins if you want to create horror music. I don't know. Then we have a Humanizer, which is a nice randomizer tool. You can randomize all kinds of stuff. So maybe the delay is a little bit off. Sometimes the velocity is a little bit different. The tuning is a little bit different. The volume and panning and all that. It can be quite fun. These are effects that I have seen a lot in other sample players like Omnisphere, for example. So it's nice. I removed them all so we can see, but we have more. We have MIDI compressor. This is, all DAWs have this. You can just tell the Opus to play a certain way. So maybe the velocity is always between a certain level or number. So it works like a normal compressor, but in terms of velocity, but you can even change the CC and all kinds of stuff. Then we have a MIDI echo, which adds extra notes by MIDI. So it's not an effect. It's not an audio effect. It actually adds notes. Can maybe save you some time in when you do certain repetitive patterns. Then we have pocket recorder. It's an interesting little thing. You can actually record what you're playing here. So, I like that idea. I don't know if I would ever use it, but maybe I'm working in standalone or something. I'm like, what was that melody? And I can record it here and save it. Cute. Then I have a restrictor scale, which is very fun. Probably be mostly useful when you use the harp. You can set, you know, a specific key and then a scale. You can set different parameters here and you can drag your keys across the keyboard and then you will always get those notes. So very nice. Then you have a transpose, which is, you know, basic stuff. You can also store these presets, which can be very nice if you want a specific way to always open up the same way. Then automation, quite advanced actually. What you see here on the left side is stuff that is already assigned. So if you go back to the player, you can right click on these and you can add automation or learn MIDI assignment if you want that. I've noticed that quite a few controls you can't do this with yet. I don't know if that means it's going to come in an update or they're not done. But it would be nice to be able to control these, for example. But you can control them by right-clicking. And then it tells you here in automation which one are used. You can also remove them if you want to. Then you have MIDI controller mapping. This is really good. I changed my mapping here in the player very quickly. Now I loaded a different instrument, but I could change it to one there, for example. But you can also do that in the automation. So if you want the modulation wheel to be controlled by breath control, you could do that right here. And now it's controlling that. So you have a lot of options here you can change. So I could also have macros, for example. So let's say we have a macro and I want the modulation wheel to be controlled and I also want the expression to be controlled. So now when I move the macro here, both these controls are controlled. It could be quite a lot of advanced things you can do just with the mod wheel here itself if you wanted to. All right, and then you can store and save them as well. So here on articulations, this is interesting. Now they give you a lot of control because that was a complaint a little bit with the Play Engine. You didn't have a lot of control of the key switches. So here you can do a lot. You can select if they're on and off, if they're loaded into memory. You can also select now how you want it to be controlled. Most common ways is with a specific key. But one problem with the Play Engine was that before there were only a certain sets of keys you could use. You couldn't use anyone you liked. So now you can. You can just type it in here, any key you want. But it doesn't end there. You can also control it other ways. You can have, for example, program change, if you like that. Or the controller. Maybe you want the sustain pedal to change something. Or the velocity. That can be very nice, for example, like SynSample does it. You can set it up in such a way that if you hold the sustain pedal down, it will be legato. And otherwise, it will be staccato. Can be very nice. Or if you hit the key harder, it will be a certain articulation and softer, another articulation. So you have lots of control here. So this is where you need to go if you really want to mess with key switches. And then they will show up here. And then you can always load or unload the ones you want to use at that time, One more thing I want to add, though, is that you can always look here on the right side what's going on. Now, it's not perhaps super interesting, but there's one thing that I find really cool is that you can change tuning, you can change what key, and you can also have different scales. Now, this does exist in the Play Engine as well. It's here, and you go down here. But I just wanted to show you so you know that you can go in and mess with those parameters here. So let's talk about the Perform tab. And this is quite cool, actually. I haven't heard much about it. You can use this Perform tab and create a lot of interesting things. So here I have already loaded two instruments that are on the same channel, so I can play them at the same time. And obviously, when the range stops for the violins, the cello continues. So that's just the most simple way to do this. You can have several instruments playing at the same time, but that's nothing new, right? So let's look what else we can do. Well, we can turn them on and off here, obviously. Let's say we want to change where this is played. So if I move this up, I've moved actually where the cello is being played. So when I play higher up now, it will sound lower. And in that way, I created kind of a performance patch where there's an octave apart. So that's a very, very, very simple way, but this could be particularly effective if you use, for example, cellos and basses, which often play an octave apart. So you could create then a performance here that you save, so you just load that up and you don't have to always play it. You don't have to add two instruments. You just, I have a cello bass patch, you could call it, or performance patch, that is just set that way and it's a lot easier to work with. Really good idea. But another thing you can do is that you can control it. So for example, if you have velocity, you're gonna set them both to velocity. So I want like this top one, it's gonna be use if I hit harder, and this one is going to use, actually I'm going to put 65 here, realized. So if I play very softly, it's cello, and if I play harder, it's violin. Now, this might not be the best case, but I'm just showing you that it could be more interesting if, for example, you have that depending on how hard you hit, you will have different articulations. You could do this in the key switches also, but what's even more cool is that you can have even set ranges. So for example, on this set of keys, there's one sound, and on this set of keys is a completely different sound. Or on this set of keys, two sounds are being played. You have quite a lot of options here that after a while become more advanced than just simple key switching. And also, the good thing about it is that if you set it the right way, you don't have to hit any key switches. It just changes matter on how you play. Let's take a look at the last tab, the Mix tab, which also exists in Play. It's called the Mixer tab. And they function pretty much the same way. But the difference is that the Opus is just way nicer laid out. It's easier to work with. And it also has added quite a few effects that did not exist in the Play Engine. For example, if we go into the effects here, these effects were pretty good, but they were always the same. You could turn them on and off, and you can change the presets, but that was it, pretty much. While here in the Opus Engine, you have way more effects. If you click on plus here, you will see we have different EQs, different compressors and limiters, distortion, modulation, harmonics, delay, and reverbs. So quite a bit there that you can work with. But how does this interface work? It's quite simple, and they have made quite a few things to make life easier for you. For example, we have tabs and console, and that means that if it's in tab mode, it pretty much works like a browser, like a Chrome browser, for example. Everything is grouped into tabs. So this instrument, everything I see now is just related to that instrument. If I click on this instrument, then everything is just related to that instrument. And that can be quite nice because if you have console view, then you show everything at the same time. And imagine if you had 50 instruments, there would be quite a lot to look at. So taps is pretty good. All right. And then it works like this, that anything you have selected, you see here, you can see the color what I have selected. That's what shows up here. And so we have a master channel. That's the main instrument, you can say. And then we have different mic positions. And you always have to have one mic positions loaded. In this case, it's the main one. And you can see that it's highlighted. You can click on these if you want to load the other ones or click them to unload them. All right. Then there are two ways of adding effect. You can either have them as insert. And by default, there's always an equalizer insert in the plugin, you could say. So you can turn it on and off here or down here. You can add new ones by clicking plus and new ones. You can even store the settings if you have made settings that you really like. You can turn off, on and off these shelves as well. And you can see here very nicely represented how it works. So that's one way. And then you add an insert effect that affects the whole sort of channel. You can also then work with outputs, which one you want, and you can change the volume, mute it. You can pan it. If you click on this, you turn off the send effects entirely, which I'm going to talk about later. And you can also toggle the view. Well, actually, these are toggles, sorry, not turning off. You can toggle the views of all the mic positions as well, so you can save some space. So anyway, that's insert on and off. You can also add an effect channel by clicking add effect channel up here in the corner. And then here you have to put an insert in that channel. Let's say we want an exciter. It's not a very good thing to use in a send, but I'm just showing you. So now the exciter inserted on this channel. So how do I use it? Well, you have to take one or several of these mic inputs, or these mic positions rather. You cannot use this. You have to use the mics. And then you have to pick one and send it over. So for example, we can take the main one, click plus, and I go to effect send, click on exciter or any other one I have made. And now this will be sent over and use the exciter channel as well. I can change the effect send here, or I can even do it down here if I want to. All right, and that's pretty much it. You can, of course, then store all the settings on each plugin, and you can even store the whole mix if you want to. One more thing, if you add the panels, you can get more detailed information, more in numbers and levels, which might be easier to use than knobs on an interface. So you have that option as well, which I think is really nice that they have. So as you can see, the Opus engine is quite a beast, and there's a lot of stuff under the hood. If I would compare it to the Kontakt player, which maybe wouldn't be the greatest comparison, well, I would say that the Kontakt is more about manipulating every little detail about your samples and create great content, while the Opus engine has focused more on really creating a great experience, you know, streamlining every little thing, making sure you can do things the way you want it in order to create music quickly, to have everything set up and just go without thinking too much of it. I also wanted to say, if you're thinking about upgrading to Opus, for example, you have bought the Hollywood Orchestra and you don't have the subscription, well, it will become much more clear to you as we talk about the orchestra in the next video and also the orchestrator to see the whole package of things, if it makes sense to you. But I did want to say that the Play is still good. It's still quite fast if you set it up correctly, and you can still create really good results that are pretty much identical to the Opus engine. Obviously, the Opus engine has a few more things, and it's way more streamlined and is much easier to work, and it's just better in general. Obviously, yes, it is. But the Play is still not bad, and it's still good enough. So until the next video about the orchestra, this is Sam signing out. Take care.